Hello, this is Lazarus at Telecom Tech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining how to configure multi-protocol BGP Ethernet VPN for VXLAN with inter-VNI communications using a transit VNI. We'll be configuring all of this on Cisco Nexus switches. If you like my content so far and you're interested in seeing more networking and telecom technologies simply explained, please don't forget to subscribe to the channel. And when you subscribe, make sure that you enable notifications like so that you'll be informed of new content. If you like this video, once again, make sure to click that thumbs up button. In my previous video, we went over how to deploy an MP-BGP EVPN control plane for VXLAN when spanning a single VNI across the VXLAN topology, like so. Here we can see that both PC1 and PC2 are in the same subnet and they're using the same VNI. However, in this video, we'll be exploring the case where our hosts are in different subnets and thus in different VNIs. In such a case, there must be routing taking place somewhere on the topology. Now, we've gone over the mechanisms with which such a topology functions several videos ago. However, in this video, we'll actually see the configurations on the Cisco Nexus switches. Now, this configuration will be somewhat similar to the one we did with the layer 2 communication, so many of the same concepts will apply, but we'll see at what point these differ in order to enable routing and layer 3 operations. Now, just a quick reminder as to the concepts involved in this layer 3 operation. We'll be creating a transit VNI, which we will designate VNI 6500. And within each VTEP, we'll create the SVI that will act as the default gateway. On VTEP 1, that's VLAN 12 with this IP address. And on VTEP 2, that's VLAN 13 with this IP address. We will also create a transit VLAN, which we will associate with the transit VNI 6500, which will be applied to these NVE interfaces here. Now, once a packet reaches the transit SVI here, it will use the MP-BGP EVPN mechanisms for VXLAN to find the corresponding VTEP2 to achieve the routing. So let's get down to how to configure the VTEPs. Now, at this point, we've already configured the underlay network with OSPF, with multicast PIM sparse mode, which of course, as you remember, is still a prerequisite. And we've configured this spine switch here as the rendezvous point for our multicast PIM sparse mode infrastructure. Now, the configuration of the spine switch here is the same as our layer 2 VNI setup in the previous video. We enable BGP, we configure a neighbor relationship with VTEP 1, we configure the remote AS, the loopback as the update source for BGP messages, and then we specify an address family of L2 VPN EVPN so that MAC addresses can be shared using BGP. Now, to make this work, remember, we have to enable BGP extended communities, and we also have to configure our VTEP 1 neighbor as a root reflector client. Now, we configure exactly the same thing for the spine's IBGP peering with VTEP 2. The configs are exactly the same except for the neighbor IP address here. So far, for either layer 2 or layer 3, our configuration of the spine and the underlay network is exactly the same. Now, the difference comes in at the configuration of the VTEPs. Now, we're not going to configure the BGP settings of our VTEPs just yet, and there's a reason for this. You'll see this shortly. We will start off by configuring a virtual routing and forwarding instance, or a VRF, in each leaf switch. Now, in our case, we only have a single customer on our VXLAN infrastructure, which is connecting these two sites. But in many cases, within data centers and cloud deployments where VXLAN is used, we have to separate the traffic from multiple customers in some way. This type of deployment is called a multi-tenancy deployment, where the network hosts multiple tenants. So we've created a VRF here that we'll call my customer, and will configure both VLAN SVIs 12 and 1213 on VTEP 1 to be part of that VRF. We do something similar on VTEP 2 as well. So let's see, first of all, how we're going to configure VTEP 1. We start off by creating the VRF in VTEP 1. We do that by issuing the VRF context my customer command, and then we associate VNI 6500 with that VRF. Remember, 6500 is the transit VNI. Finally, we indicate that this VRF will be forwarding IPv4 unicast traffic. Now let's configure the VLAN associated with the transit VNI, as well as our local host's VLAN. We configure VLAN 1213, which is our transit VLAN, and we associate it with VNI 6500. Next, we configure the SVI of the 1213 VLAN, enable it, and configure it as a member of our VRF. Next, we issue the IP forward command. Now, this command essentially tells the switch to route, encapsulate, and decapsulate VXLAN packets. So the VXLAN encapsulation and decapsulation takes place at this SVI interface. Next, we configure our VLAN 12, which is the VLAN to which the PC1 host belongs. We associate VNI 6501 with that VLAN. And finally, we configure the VLAN 12 SVI, which acts as the default gateway of the subnet to which PC1 belongs. We enable it, associate it with our VRF, and assign it an IP address. Next, we're going to create and configure our NVE1 interface on VTEP 1. And this is done like so. This is much the same as our L2 VNI configuration. We enable the port, we configure BGP as the protocol that will share the MAC addresses as well. We make the NVE interface become a member of VNI 6501, and in that configuration, we also configure the multicast group, as well as one more command. Now, this is the command that makes our transit VNI function to route traffic to the remote VTEP. It's the member VNI 6500 associate VRF command. This command associates the 6500 VNI with VNI 6501, which is in the associated VRF. In other words, routing will take place using the MCAS group 239.1.1.1 and will be transferred over the transit VNI of 6500. Now, we can finally configure our MP-BGP configuration for our VTEP 1 device. Now, we configure it in much the same way as we did with our Layer 2 VNI deployment. And we do it like so. We have our neighbor IP, which is our spine, the remote AS, which is the same as our own VTEP's AS, which means that we're using IBGP. We configure the loopback 0 as our BGP source interface, and we configure our address family as L2 VPN EVPN to share MAC addresses. And as before, we enable our BGP extended communities. Now, there's one more bit of configuration that we have to do here to bring it all together. Under our BGP configuration, we advertise the network on which PC1 resides. This way, both the spine switch as well as VTEP2 will learn about that network. And that's all of the configuration on VTEP 1. Let's go through the same configurations, somewhat quicker, on VTEP 2. It'll be a good refresher as we review what we've done so far. So on VTEP 2, we start again by creating our VRF My Customer, and we associate it with the transit VNI 6500. We also specify that this VRF will carry IPv4 unicast traffic. Next, we configure the VLANs on VTEP 2, as well as the VLAN SVIs. Here we start with VLAN 1213 and associate it with the transit VNI 6500. We then create the 1213 SVI, enable it, and associate it with our VRF and enable IP forwarding. Then we associate VLAN 13, which is the VLAN on which our host PC2 resides, with VNI 6502. And finally, we create our SVI 13, which acts as the default gateway for PC2 subnet, and enable it, associate our VRF with it, and assign it an IP address. Next, we configure the NVE interface. And as before, we configure BGP as the protocol to share the MAC addresses. And we configure member VNI 6502. And under that configuration, we use the 239.1.1.1 multicast group. And we specify 6500 as a member VNI in the associated VRF to enable routing via the transit VNI. Next, we configure our IBGP peering with the spine switch, configuring our L2 VPN EVPN address family and our extended BGP communities. And finally, we add our VRF to the BGP router configuration, indicating the network on which PC2 resides, which is 192.168.13.0/24. This way, this route is advertised to the spine switch as well as to VTEP1. Now, as you can see, the configuration does get a bit involved, especially since we're combining multiple different technologies. We didn't show how to configure them all here, but we did mention that we have OSPF, we have multicast PIM sparse mode, we have BGP, EVPN, and we have VRFs, and all of them are being applied here and working together. So the configuration can and does get complicated, and that's why care must be taken to make sure that all is working as it should. Well, that's it for now. I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you'd like me to address other related topics, feel free to let me know in the comments below. And as always, please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this video has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.